about you, friends, but I love lighthouses. Stone kingdoms, beacons of light, shining forth in the midst of darkness. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. He also told us that there's a city, and the city which is set upon a hill. This hill represents the rock. Jesus Christ is that solid rock. The beginnings of the kingdom. We are part of that city, the New Jerusalem. I want you to stay tuned, friends, because we have some exciting things to share with you about the light and that New Jerusalem.
There's so much of the Bible, so much of history that, I should say history that relates to the Bible that people don't know anything about. They're kept in darkness.
So the entire Bible really deals with the kingdom. The people, the law, the land, the type of government, constitutional monarchy, and the king himself.
Angles, the Saxons, the Danes, the Jutes, the Normans, and many other groups of people entering the British Isles in the Middle Ages, right from the 5th century forward. He says that all can be identified as being racially of the one people. And he says they can all be traced back in their movements across Europe towards the British Isles as to the very Caucasus of southern Russia, which is the very part where 10 tribes of Israel were carried captive.
Because the whole purpose of God is to bless all the families of the earth. And the promise that Abraham was given in Genesis chapter 12 was specifically that through him would be blessed all the families of the earth.
The wonderful part I find about all of this is the consistency of God. Yes. Here we've got the consistency of God's plan coming through with his law, with Israel, from the Old Testament into the New Testament.
You have a destiny, a great divine destiny. You have a rich heritage, the kingdom of God. Has an application and a direct bearing upon your heritage.
My name is Catherine Jane Cameron Sage, and I live primarily in Carmel, California, on the Monterey Peninsula. My second home is in Glastonbury, England, in Somerset, and that's who I am.
And so this is what Christianity really is, because the natural man moves into the spiritual realm where the living Lord of glory, the Lord Jesus Christ, comes to us and reveals himself and that word to us. And this is what makes Christianity become alive.
Hello, I'm Pastor Barley of America's Promise Ministries. I want to thank you for taking some of your precious time to join us for this particular documentary. I believe you're going to enjoy it and be greatly blessed by the information you're going to learn
hear concerning God's plan and purposes for you, my friends. The inspiration for this particular film came from Heirs of the Promise Part 1, produced by Pastor Sheldon Emery. He produced this film back in the early 70s, and it was used in a great way to help thousands upon thousands of people come to understand their true biblical identity. Now, a lot of you aren't aware that you do have a biblical identity. Some of you that are watching this particular film right now are going to think, well, I'm just a Gentile, and I really don't have any real connection to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
Are you aware of any biblical heritage with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob of the Bible?
No, I'm not aware of any.
I'm not aware of any bloodline relationship.
Well, I'm not real aware of any biblical heritage.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Are you aware of any biblical heritage you have with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob of the Bible?
Yes, I'm very aware of that.
I'm related to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob through faith in God.
Good morning, sir. Are you aware of any biblical heritage with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob of the Bible?
No, I'm not. I'm not aware.
Are you aware of any biblical heritage you have with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob of the Bible?
No, I'm not aware.
Good afternoon, sir. Do you have any awareness of your biblical heritage with Abraham, Isaac, or Jacob of the Bible?
No, I can't say that I do.
Now, if you'll stop and you'll think about it and go back in your word and you can verify this for yourself, in the book of Genesis, just a few chapters, right after Adam comes on the scene, here comes Abraham, a great man of faith, and God Almighty made an everlasting, eternal covenant with Abraham and his seed through Isaac.
Beginning with Abraham, God told Abraham, I'm going to use you and your seed, and through you and your seed, I'm going to bless all the families of the earth. So he chose a people that came through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to be his servant nation in the earth to proclaim these very things. So, and in fact, the entire book of Genesis talks about the...
As for me, my covenant is with thee. Thou shalt be called a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name any more be called Abraham, but thy name shall be Abraham. For a father of many nations have I made thee, and kings shall come out of thee. And I will establish my covenant between me and thee, and thy seed after thee, for an everlasting covenant.
And of course the scriptures say, in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Now, we know that these people went into Egyptian captivity, and they went through some tough times for about 400 years. And then after that come the judges and the prophets, and then the kings for a short period of time. There was David, and then there was Solomon, and that he built that great temple, and then Rehoboam, his son. But there was a problem with Rehoboam, because Rehoboam didn't obey the elders, and he didn't have a heart to serve God, and there was a division within the kingdom. Three tribes, Benjamin, part of Levite, and Judah, went and formed the southern kingdom of Judah. And then the northern tribes of Israel under Jeroboam, they went off and formed the northern house of Israel. Basically, the 10 tribes left over, went and joined them, along with part of Levite and Benjamin as well. But there was a problem. Jeroboam followed the ways of the other nations and got involved in idolatry and idolatrous ways and introduced paganism to Israel. And God Almighty says, well, I've had enough. You Israelites made a covenant with me back at Mount Sinai. Don't you remember, he told them? And I've given you warning after warning here. And he said, I've had enough. I'm going to give you a written bill of divorcement. I'm going to separate you and put you away. Well, that was pretty devastating, because they no longer carried the name. They no longer carried the blessing, seemingly, that God Almighty had given to them at Mount Sinai. Now, this is important for us to understand, because this history of Israel was given to them. This great heritage was given to Israel through Abraham. Now, the Mosaic Covenant, which was given to Israel at Mount Sinai, was a conditional covenant. It was a marriage covenant in which God Almighty says, I'll do my part, Israel, if you'll do your part. And Israel said, sure, it sounds like a great idea. Great, there was a marriage covenant cut and formed. But prior to this, a covenant was cut called the Abrahamic covenant, in which God Almighty gave His word. He didn't require Abraham's word. He made an eternal, everlasting covenant with Abraham that He would make and form Israel into a multiple of nations, and that through Israel, all the nations of the world would be blessed. And the only way that can happen, my friends, is for them to be a Christian people, to carry out God's law, the biblical principles from His word, and be a light and a blessing to the other nations.
Because Israel were supposed to be a people who were to spread abroad throughout the earth. And they were to be a blessing to all the families of the earth. How could they be a blessing to all nations? Unless they became a great people, unless they became a prosperous people, unless they became a people who were doing exactly what the Christian nations are doing today. A people who have propagated the gospel, sent Bibles out. Doesn't the scripture say that the law of the Lord and the word of the Lord would go forth from Zion and from Jerusalem?
Absolutely, yes.
And it hasn't gone forth from the Middle East. It has gone forth from the British Isles, from America, from the English-speaking nations in particular, who have sent the gospel out, sent Bibles out, sent missionaries out, and who have established Christian civilizations throughout the world. It's so exciting. It's staring people in the face. You wonder that we have missed it for so long.
And you have to think about this. Why is that? And you have to get your facts lined up with the Word of God, or you're going to miss the whole picture here. We want to bring God's whole plan and His purposes to you and make it real to you.
You got the Dutch. You got all these people that have trekked into Europe and come into the New World, and here we are, and we cannot answer the question, where did I come from? What am I doing here, and where am I going?
Jesus is the King of kings and the Lord of lords, the scriptures say. And He came and He said, I am not come but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He also made another important statement that my sheep know my voice. These are important statements because Jesus lays out in His word that I'm carrying on the covenant that God Almighty gave to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and I am looking at and seeking for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He also established the new covenant. What is the new covenant? Well, when you turn in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 8, verses 8 through 11, you will see that this new covenant speaks directly to Judah and Israel, Israel, the northern house whom was divorced. And Jesus is saying basically in here, I'm going to bring you two nations together and form you under the bonds of a new covenant. And I'm going to write my law, my will, my plan, and my purposes in your heart. This is exciting. And this gets to the very heart of the matter that I've been sharing with you concerning the kingdom of God and the new Jerusalem. But I want to take you right now to an important segment that we did in an interview with archaeologist E. Raymond Capp. I believe it's going to bless your heart. That kind of fits in with what we want to do here. And ladies and gentlemen, I want to welcome you to this special interview. We're at the home of archaeologist E. Raymond Capp. Mr. Capp, it is indeed a pleasure to be with you here.
My pleasure, too.
And to share with us some interesting things concerning the covenant people and their migrations. Now, I want to begin with going back a number of years ago to a special interview you did with Pastor Sheldon Emery, and he did a film. Do you remember that interview, and do you remember the name of that film?
Heirs of the Promise. I remember it clearly.
Right.
That was at that time,
there was only a handful of ministers in America, I would guess less than 25, that were not glossing over or ignoring the Old Testament in their preaching. Yet we know 4/5 of the Word of God is found in the Old Testament. And that is the basis and foundation of the teachings of Jesus Christ. Well, Pastor Sheldon and me were one of those few, a little handful of ministers that did not gloss over the Old Testament.
No, he didn't.
Hello, I am Pastor Sheldon Emery of Lord's Covenant Church of Phoenix, Arizona.
Mr. Cap with our questions.
This interesting little marble head was found in the vicinity of Ephesus in Turkey.
Is that an identifiable historical figure?
Well, at the present time, we have not identified him, but we hope to do so. I would suggest he's of the Byzantine period, about the 4th or 5th century AD.
And it brings back fond memories of those times.
Well, his interview of me gave me the opportunity to bring to Caucasian Americans the archaeological evidence that they are the lost tribes of Israel. And of course, in that interview, I dealt with the captivity and the migrations of Israel based on archaeology.
So the question boils down to this. What did happen to the millions, yes, millions of Israelites, who were driven out of Palestine 700 years before Christ? And where were they, if they existed at all, at the time Paul uttered his statement of confidence in God keeping his promises to Israel? Can we find out what happened to them so that their descendants can be identified in the world today? For a visual answer to that question, we are going to call on E. Raymond Capp, a Bible student and biblical archaeologist from California.
Mr. Capp has traveled and studied extensively in Europe and the Mideast. He lectures on the Dead Sea Scrolls, on the pyramids of Egypt, and on other archaeological subjects. Mr. Capp is the author of books on the Great Pyramid, on astronomy and the Bible, on Stonehenge of England and Druidism, on Solomon's Temple, on ancient Israel, and he has written an excellent Bible study on the Abrahamic Covenants. Now to Mr. Capp with our question.
As a minister, I know there is an abundance of prophecy concerning the destiny of Israel, but there is no Bible history of this portion of Israel referred to in 2 Kings 17:6. In the 9th year of Hoshea, the king of Assyria took Samaria and carried Israel away into Assyria and placed them in Halah and in Habor by the river of Gozan and in the city of the Medes. The Bible history of this major part of Israel ends here, and yet the prophets and the New Testament promise an increase in numbers, great blessings, and an eventual restoration. With the passing of 2,500 years since this Assyrian captivity, one might think that all hope of tracing these Israelites is lost. Ray, can archaeology answer this question?
Yes, Pastor Emery, it has. During the last 100 years, a number of archaeological teams have been working in the Middle East. They have unearthed and published the original contemporary accounts of the Syrians who took the Israelites captive. It is from these records that vital clues have come to light. In fact, these records are found in the form of cuneiform tablets, such as I show you here. These were found at Nineveh in 1900 and published in 1930. However, their relevance to Israel was overlooked then because they were found in complete disorder and amongst about 1,400 other texts. The tablets were Assyrian frontier post reports dated about 707 BC. They described the activities of a people called Gemira, who lived in the land of Gemir. The descriptions of Gemir described the area the Israelites had been placed just a few years earlier. They were called Masagedi and Saka. Archaeology has solved two of the greatest archaeological problems. First, what happened to the hundreds of thousands of Israelites who disappeared south of the Caucasus? And second, the origin of the Sumerians and the mysterious nomadic tribes known as Scythians who suddenly appeared north of the Caucasus both the same time in history. They were one and the same people. They were Israelites. Our history books pick up the story at this point, recording the westward migrations of the Scythians as they came into collision with the Sumerians, who had earlier settled west of the Black Sea. Their kinship lost over the centuries The ensuing battles forced the Sumerians west and north to become the Celts, Gauls, and Cimbri. By the end of the 4th century BC, the Scythians had established themselves as the great and prosperous kingdom of Scythia. Later, the Sarmatians, these were a mixed non-Israelite people of Iranian origin, they in turn drove the Scythians northwest to the shores of the Baltic Sea. At this time in history, we find the Romans introduced the name German in place of the name Scythian in order not to confuse the Scythians with the Sarmatians now who occupied Scythia. Germanus, being the Latin name for genuine, indicates the Germans were the genuine Scythians. During this time, the Celts were expanding in all directions from Central Europe. Some of the Celts moved into Spain and became known as Iberians, the Gaelic name for Hebrews. Others poured into Britain to form the bedrock of the British race. Later, the Iberians moved into Ireland as Scots, and later into northern Britain to establish the nation of Scotland. Your history books also record the Germanic tribes breaking up into many divisions, the Angles, Saxons, Jutes, Danes, and Vikings, to name just a few. Other Germanic tribes later poured into the lands vacated by the Celts and established the Gothic nations, the Vandals, Lombards, Franks, Burgundians, and others. The so-called lost tribes of Israel were really never lost. They only lost their identity as they migrated westward over the centuries from the land of their captivity.
And there you have it, my friends. Mr. Kapp has given us a visual answer to our question, what happened to the millions of Israelites who were dispersed out of old Canaan land 7 centuries before Christ and who never returned? They migrated onto the continent of Europe and were the ancestors of the white European race. And in answering our question about Israel's disappearance, Mr. Kapp has given us the key to several other mysteries of world history.
We're not told this in our present-day history books.
Because they don't realize who they are. They're a continuity of the tribes of Israel from captivity migrating west.
Because of the captivity, and when you're in captivity, you don't have any say-so of your name, you don't have any say-so of where they're going to put you, and they gave the tribes of Israel different names, didn't they?
Yes, they also had some freedom. A lot of people imagine they went there as slaves, slave masters, beating them, making them work to death. No, no, no. They were actually moved in that area.
You got to think about something else. They were not slaves in Assyrian captivity. Let's get that straight. They were actually taken over there and let to build their own cities. They might move them out of the country if they couldn't declare war. They're in a strange area.
Because their captors knew they'd be far more productive that way.
And productive, too. And they allowed to have their own government, but they had to pay certain their royalty, I guess you might call it that, or other economy, to the crown. And they were buffers to protect the borders around Assyria. They weren't there to become slaves. They wanted to buffer out there. In those days, they were fighting each other. And
their feeling was, if you had these Israelites around them, and anyone coming against them had to go through them first. And of course, they would fight, and that's what happened. We have records in the archaeological tablets describing these the very events happening.
Discovered some fascinating things about Israel when you were touring Britain, and you were actually in a British museum there, and you found some interesting things about Israel's history.
Well, I was able to identify some tablets found in the British Museum. They were made by the Assyrians who took the Israelites captive. And that, so I don't say I didn't discover, I just identified.
Right.
But they had not been identified before. They were mixed up among about 20,000 tablets. And the Assyrians I worked with were found in 1850 by the University of Pennsylvania. And I mean, it was 1930 before they were translated. And they had 20,000 tablets. That's a lot of tablets.
Yes,
what they did, first they did, they all the ones that had a name of Ashurbanipal, Sargon, all these Nebuchadnezzar, these king lines of Assyria, they laid them one side. You know, they have 1,470 of them. Now, Professor Waterman of the University of Michigan, he translated them. And he translated and found the tablets described, the Israelites were called different names. Gomera was one of them.
Right.
And another called Iskuzi. And Iskuzi was, they didn't directly from the Israel name was changed directly to one to the other. And then they found these on the tablets.
The tablets only cover a very small section of what I'm trying to overall tell you about. The Assyrians who took the Israelites captive, they did keep records of them in cuneiform tablets. And they were found, they're in the British Museum today. Like I said, I didn't discover them. I located them and found that they're identified them. And they describe exactly step by step how, what they did to them and how they left. Now, when they started leaving, and of course the cuneiform tablets drop off, don't tell their losses.
Right.
But the Greeks kept records of them, the Romans kept records of them, and they pick up the very names where the Israelites, Assyrians stopped. And so those tablets are, they're scientific proof, you might say. People say, well, your interpretation of the Bible. Show me some archaeological proof. We got it. All you got to do is listen to it.
And it happened. Urartu, when time came up, Urartu is up near Lake Van, and they were coming up raising an army, and the Assyria was always worrying about them getting closer. And some of these tablets we found were spy reports. They had spies out here keeping track of what goes on, is what the Israelites are doing and what the enemy is doing. And in one tablet is actually dated 707 B.C., and it told about the land of Urartu come up against the land of Israel. They call them, of course, Syria, the Cimmerian, and how they counterattacked it, and they did the job they're supposed to do.
Well, there's a lot of history, again, to uncover.
There's so much of the Bible, so much of history that relates to the Bible that people don't know anything about. They're kept in darkness. There's a lot we don't understand. People don't read history. And to know the Bible, you have to read Bible history or history of those countries to understand it properly. Amen.
Well, I want to move up to the time of Christ now. Many people don't realize there's a great history that has yet to be uncovered, but you've taken the time over the years to go to many lands. I know you've been to Europe and to England, and you've uncovered some fantastic things about the early years of Jesus that perhaps we'll get a chance to get into in this interview. But one of your booklets, you had a description of Jesus in it, and I'd like for you to share with us some information about this, because when I went to the university, they told me that Jesus was probably some short, olive-skinned Jew, and when I read your description of Jesus, it's quite different. Could you elaborate?
Well, this isn't my description. This is a historical record. In fact, we have one letter from Pontius Pilate to Tiberius Caesar. He describes Christ, among other things, being taller than average, had golden-colored hair and beard.
Golden-colored hair.
And that's in the Congressional Library in Washington. Now, the other contains in much more detail. This is written by a resident of Judea. This is during the reign of Tiberius Caesar, and, of course, written to him. This first appeared in the writings of a saint of Canterbury in the 11th century A.D. And when you mentioned in your letter to me that you asked a question about did I have any descriptions of Christ that I'd published? Could I share those? I said yes. So what I did, I have a copy of it from my publications, The Resurrection Tomb. I'll read that. This is a book, by the way, The Resurrection Tomb. This man wrote, quote, "There lives at this time in Judea a man of singular virtue whose name is Jesus Christ, whom the barbarians esteem as a prophet, but his followers love and adore him as the offspring of the immortal God. He calls back the dead from the graves, heals all sorts of diseases with a word or touch." Now here's the description. "He's a tall man, well-shaped, amicable and reverent aspect. His hair is a color that can hardly be matched, falling into graceful curls, waving about and very agreeable, crouching upon his shoulders. parted on the crown of his head, running as a stream to the front after the fashion of the Nazarenes. His forehead is high, large, and imposing. His cheeks without spot or wrinkle. Beautiful with a lovely red. His nose and mouth formed with exquisite symmetry. His beard and of the color suitable to his hair. Reaching below his chin and parted in the middle like a fork. His eyes are bright blue. How many pictures you've seen showing darks? Clear and serene. Look innocent, dignified, manly, and mature. In proportion, a body most perfect, captivating his arms and his hands, delectable to behold.
That's not a Imagine a good many of you were not aware of that description of Jesus, with blonde hair and blonde locks in his hair and blue eyes. Well, that's just a small little sample of what we're going to be sharing with you. But I want to take you back now to the subject of the migrations of the tribes of Israel. The Word of God tells us that Israel wandered after their Assyrian captivity, after they had become lost. History tells us that they had become lost and that they wandered into the various nations. Now, the reason I'm saying that is because the Word of God uses the word scattering.
Pastor Sheldon Emery always talked about how we were divorced, but he also brought up the fact we were going to be remarried. And in the Hebrew law, when a husband dies, the wife then can remarry. And I believe that Jesus Christ had married Israel. When he died on the cross, that fulfilled the law of release of the wife to marry again. And it says in the Bible, you're going to remarry her. He said, he who scattered Israel is going to gather Israel.
That's a tremendous love story.
And Israel was scattered. Israel had become lost to their identity. And they became literally Gentilized, or another word for this would be paganized. They entered into idolatry. They became an idolatrous people, and they worshiped false gods. Things were not looking good for them, but this was a matter of divine, the God's hand directing his people into these various lands for his divine purposes. Now, this is very important what I'm sharing with you here, because the Word of God tells us in a number of places, such as in Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 8, that Israel would become blind, a people that are blind but would have eyes. In other words, yes, they have eyes, but they would not be able to really see or remember their former state as Israelites. And over a matter of, let's say, centuries, it's easy to see how this can happen. And just look at the changes that's occurred in our nation in the last 200 years. We have forgotten our Christian beginnings, our great biblical heritage.
Mr. Kapp, I, for the life of me, can't understand why people will turn a deaf ear to their history and their origin. In your reading of God's Word, over and over, they preserve the heritage, they preserve the seed line, and they write down their family origin. It's recorded over and over in the Word of God. Why do you think they recorded them?
The ministers are not telling the truth of the people. They don't bring out the Old Testament at all. Because remember this. They all teach Israel, the lost tribes of Israel, the 10 tribes, moved up here, lost and gone forever. And the point I want to make out is, and show you, they did not stay there and amalgamate with the people. They migrated. And we have evidence to back that up.
Much like we did here in the United States of America, when they landed here, we continued to migrate westward.
Now remember, God told Israel, you're going to go into captivity. He described what's going to happen to them. We have history can prove step by step how it happened. He also said he's going to regather them. How can you regather them if they're all going to be, they're gone and lost forever? And only one tribe left. He made promises to each one of those sons of Jacob. He promised them great things in the future. Now, if you just keep that thought in mind, how can you say they're lost and gone forever? There's something wrong here. They've been taught wrong. They migrated out and became great nations, all of them.
And the Word of God does explicitly say in the book of Genesis unto Abraham, I'm going to make you a father of many nations. Not just one nation, but many nations. So we know that certainly couldn't apply to that little piece of real estate over there in Palestine.
Well, it's so clear to us because we have read and studied the material. And if any of us could read and study the material available, they'll come to the same conclusion as we will.
Now, in Isaiah chapter 42 and verse 16, the Word of God says this to Israel, I will bring the blind by a way that they knew not, and I will lead them in parts that they have not known. And I will make darkness light before them, and the crooked things straight. These things will I do unto them, and not forsake them. Now this is long after God Almighty had divorced Israel and put them away. And he's saying, though I have divorced them, and though I have put them away, I will not forsake them. And these Israelites scattered into Europe, and they became known as Scythians, Goths, the Celts, the Cumri, the Sumerians, and the Saxons.
Carried on from Israel times. And what does the Sake mean? What are Saxons? They are Isaac's sons. Another significant fact is the name Britain. Brit is from the ancient word Brith, meaning covenant. Brithain, meaning covenant land, or Britham, which also means people of the covenant. And British, Ish is an Israelite word for man, covenant man. So covenant man, covenant people, covenant land. They were Saxons, they were Angles. And the Angles was a Hebrew name for bullocks. And bullock is the symbol of the tribes of Joseph, Ephraim and Manasseh, were described as the bullocks and unicorns. A unicorn is an old name for bullocks, and we have the unicorn also as a symbol in our heraldry, not forgetting the lion, which is also part of Israel's heraldry. The lion and the unicorn. Why should those two symbols of ancient Israel be so much a part of the heritage of modern Britain, for instance? Well, of course, because we descended from the ancient people of Israel.
Revealing, quote, concerning Israel. Could you share that with us, please?
Yes, Sir Arthur Bland was a great British historian and has written many, many books on history, one of which is the history of the English-speaking peoples, which would include America, of course, as well. He covered all that. And in that encyclopedia, which he was a series of books, he stated clearly that the Angles, the Saxons, the Danes, the Jutes, the Normans, and many other groups of people entered the British Isles in the Middle Ages, right from the 5th century forward. He says they all can be identified as being racially of the one people. And he says they can all be traced back in their movements across Europe towards the British Isles as to the very Caucasus of southern Russia, which is the very part
Wow.
where 10 tribes of Israel were carried captive.
That is a fantastic
And point. There's another name that they were known by as well, and I want to share with you from this particular book. It is called The Lost 10 Tribes of Israel Found by Stephen Collins. This is a tremendous book giving a great deal of history concerning Israel. And he says on page 220, that the Israelites became the Iberians and the Scythians and the Parthians. He says the Parthians were Israelites of the 10 tribes of Israel who had migrated to Asia. The Bible records that these tribes were placed in the city of the Medes, and Parthia's homeland adjourned the territory of the Medes. Parthians were first under the dominion of the Assyrians, and that was also the fate of those Israelites taken captive by the Assyrians. He says that the Parthians were the kinsmen of the Scythians or the Sakai. The Parthians and the Scythians are the people written about by Josephus. And he says that Josephus was a first century historian who lived in Rome and followed the Israelites. He made a great detailed notes of the Israelites and their migrations. And he gives this quote by Josephus, and I want to share that with you right here. He says, quote, "The 10 tribes, the so-called lost 10 tribes of Israel, are beyond the Euphrates until now and are an immense multitude and not to be estimated by number," end of quote. These Israelites weren't lost. They weren't just a small group of people, but they were in the millions, and Josephus records their history. And what we want to do is share with you some additional history on those Israelites at this time.
Hi, friends. We're up here in the beautiful Rocky Mountains near the Canadian border, and I want to tell you, the scenery and the terrain here is magnificent. It reminds me of the Scandinavian countries. I don't know if you've had the opportunity to ever travel to Norway, Sweden, or Denmark, but the terrain's very similar to that up here. The air is fresh and clean. But what I want to share with you is something exciting concerning the migrations of the tribe of Dan, Zebulun, Asher, Simeon. You can see their marks and you can see their symbols and their banners all over the Scandinavian countries. And I have with me some books that share with you much more information on that. I'm only going to share with you a little bit that of the information given in these books. And one of the first ones I want to share with you is a brand new book by Stephen Collins called The Origins and Empire of Ancient Israel. He shows in here that these Danites were a seafaring people and takes them from the time of Judges when they were in the land of Canaan, and there really wasn't all that much land for the expanding tribes of Israel. And he takes you through that expansion, and you'll want to get a copy of that book by Stephen Collins. The next book that I have is by William H. Bennett. It's called The Story of Celto-Saxon Israel. And in this particular book here, he goes and shares with you who Dan is, that he was the father of, obviously, one of the tribes of Israel, but they cherished Dan as one of their fathers. And that's why you can still see his name and the symbols and the banners of the tribe of Dan all over the Scandinavian countries. And also that the Danish language, the Scottish language in Ireland, and in Wales, the Gaelic language, there is a Hebrew connection. There's a Hebrew tie to the tribes of Israel.
Correct.
And of course, they moved up into the Scandinavian countries as well.
Yes, we have here the post-captivity names of Israel by William Pascoe Gord from Great Britain. And he tells us how that these people were identified in history as they journeyed toward the west. Now, this took hundreds of years. They followed up the Danube River. They followed up the Don River. This is where the Danes came from because they're of Dan. And as you travel through this and you see the history of the thing, it unfolds to us and we begin to realize, oh, isn't it wonderful? Isn't it marvelous? Could I be an actual descendant of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob of the Bible? Oh, this is glorious. This is wonderful. And Jesus Christ is real, and he's my Savior, and he's my Lord, and he's going to come and save us.
Amen.
Isn't it wonderful?
Yes, this is wonderful information. And I happen to have a copy of the Post-Captivity Names of Israel by William Pascoe Gore that Brother Southwick was referring to. And on page 38 of this book, Pascoe Gord traces these ancient Israelites through the Danube River area. And one of the ancient names that they used for this area was the land of Arzareth, which literally means, as you trace this word out, the land of Israel, which only brings more proof to bear that true history backs up the word of God. After all, we're talking about his story.
And I've got a lot of material on the Dead Sea Scrolls. It's very important because the covenant people know their identity as well as the Essenes, in a sense.
I've heard a lot of negative things about the Essenes over the years. That,
I know.
It's like that's something you find in a New Age books or something like that, and they do their best to discredit the Essenes. Obviously, there's a lot of false information circulating about the Essenes.
Just general Christians, be the Bible, should be interested in this Dead Sea Scrolls. Now, we know we're covenant people. We know our identity. As well as all Christians, we do depend on the Bible to understand God's plan for humanity, don't we?
Right.
We use the King James Bible text mainly with the knowledge it does contain mistranslations. That gives us, we use concordances to make as many corrections as we can. We do that. We have several translations that have already made the corrections for us. Now, the King James Bible, you probably know, uses a Masoretic text.
Right.
For the basis of all its foundation. You know, the oldest copy now extant is about 900 A.D., oldest one we got. And yet it was written sometime between 1 and 300 A.D. The final Dead Sea Scrolls has given us copies of Isaiah, for example, over 1,000 years older. That text going back behind the hands of several translators, and it could be to check the accuracy and possibly correct our modern Bible. In fact, in my opinion, I consider the finding of the Dead Sea Scrolls one of the two most important archaeological discoveries made in the last century. The other being, of course, the finding of the cuneiform tablets in the ancient library of Sennacherib at Nineveh. These were found in 1847. These tablets reveal the history of the Israelites in Syrian captivity, and it tells all about their escape to come become the Anglo-Saxon, Scandinavian, Celtic, and kindred people.
They're keeping pretty quiet about this.
And most importantly, they show that we are the people of the Bible and revealed our past and our future. In fact, one newly translated scroll I want to see put in publication is called The Words of the Luminaries. This is a series of prayers the Essenes were praying, and I'll quote part of it now. We thank God for remembering His covenant, coming again, in all the lands where He has exiled them. And he goes on to talk about it, get them back again. Now, this is about, they wrote that about 150 years BC. 150 years BC, they wrote the scroll. Now, our leading theologians tell us in 721 BC, they lost and gone forever, never again emerged in world history. And yet the Essenes, 500 years later, knew where they were. We know this. We studied Paul. Paul knew where they were. His gospel, you've quoted Colossians and the other.
Wasn't that fantastic? Mr. Capp shared with us some fascinating information concerning the Dead Sea Scrolls that I'm sure many of you were not aware of. And this is true history. And we believe that true history will complement God's Word. There's no conflict at all. There's some additional history that we would like to share with you concerning the migrations of Israel and the early development of the Christian church in Europe.
Some went to Asia Minor, and of course, quite a few of them went to France. That's where we trace the, in fact, there's a book written called Coming of the Saints. Yeah, I think you handled that one time. Coming of the Saints, written by John Taylor, explained how the disciples of Christ, after the crucifixion, they had to flee for their lives, and many of them went to France. Mary Magdalene, Mary Cleopas, Lazarus, Zacchaeus, quite a few of them went to France. In fact, we have evidence of being there.
Now, when you're talking about Lazarus, you're talking about the man that Jesus raised from the dead?
Raised from the dead, and he... You know, he's actually the first bishop of the Marseille Cathedral, and they know it back there. Why America doesn't even know half what the French people know about their own people?
That is interesting, because the different races out there seem to know where they came from. They know their identity, but the white people seem to be very ignorant of their history and their true identity.
Mm-hmm. They have a grotto in France where Mary Magdalene did her ministry. I was in it.
You were there. You were actually there.
Yeah. But let's be honest about it. We know she was in a grotto in that area, the bomb area, but I was in that grotto, and it can't be the right one. Many times we have the correct story, but the wrong location. The grotto, by the way, is a very large one, and today it's full of icons and altars. Rome took over.
It's been paganized then.
Paganized, but that isn't all. The water drips from the ceiling all the time. It's sopping wet in there. She would have died of pneumonia in a short time. Actually, it's all quite a ways up the hill, too.
Yeah.
And there's no place to grow anything, no water up there, except this natural spring dropping in the ceiling. Now, I believe she was there, but it had to be down near the bottom where this cavern's down the bottom, too. They picked the wrong location.
Well, you talked about Mary Magdalene. What about Mary, the mother of Jesus?
Okay, after they were there for some years, Joseph Arimathea took Mary and another group of disciples and left France and went to England.
Now, who's Joseph of Arimathea?
The great uncle of Jesus.
Right.
The uncle of Mary. Now, the Bible doesn't say too much about him. He's a rich man who gave his tomb for Christ to be buried in. The guy out of France, another interesting point, notice, I did a film on that, Coming of the Saints. Ever heard of little tax man, Zacchaeus?
Zacchaeus, right.
Zacchaeus, up in the tree when Christ walked by. He was with the group that went to France. And when they got there, they sort of split up. Each of them they had a message to tell the world. They had a message. They had been dedicated. They saw, witnessed the resurrection of Christ.
It's the greatest message in the world.
They were tied, you know, really accurate. They knew the Bible was, the story of Christ was correctly. But they went to, he went to a little town up in the hill, mountains. I was up there. And they loved him. He did missionary work up there. And when he died, they changed the name of the town to Rocamadour, because his name was changed before that to Amador, from Zacchaeus to Amador, which means the loving one. They love him. And his tomb is up there.
Isn't Mary buried in Glastonbury?
I believe she is. These records, of course, are not in the Bible. They're in historical records. Now, not everything, not all history is found in the Bible. But what you do find, history, it always correlates. It doesn't conflict the Bible. It fits in.
Now, this history certainly does show that the Christian faith moved westward, northward and westward, and became the stronghold of Europe and the white race.
Mm-hmm. We can trace these Western European nations, many of them, their background is Scythian, Germanic, meaning genuine, and Celtic. We can trace them right back through archaeology now to the Assyrian captivity. No question at all, if a person's willing to look.
My name's Catherine Jane Cameron Sage. And I live primarily in Carmel, California, on the Monterey Peninsula. My second home is in Glastonbury, England, in Somerset. And that's who I am. I wanted to just say that Glastonbury, England is very near and dear to me because not only do I anciently descend from the people in Glastonbury, and why is that important? It's because they were, they were the first century Christians in the British Isles.
Tradition of Glastonbury brings in the missing years of Christ, how he went to Palestine as a young boy. About the age of 12 years old, his earthly father, Joseph the Carpenter, evidently died. Now, Joseph of Arimathea's great uncle would have charge of him, be the next of kin. And he was a famous metal merchant and had ships going back and forth between Joppa and Rome and Britain. In fact, many people don't realize he was a Roman provincial senator, and the province was Britain.
You see, Joseph of Arimathea, or Aramala, was known in many, many records to the first century as the Great Marmor, which is a very unusual title. Because It was associated with mining, and he was also called the Nobilis Decurio in Latin, which meant the noble miner or somebody of a noble stature associated with mining. You see, Joseph of Arimathea mined tin in Cornwall, England, and much of Somerset today. And that was all the Duchy of Cornwall in ancient times. And Glastonbury, England, you'll hear many people tell you that the tour in Glastonbury, England has a step pyramid shape and all that. No, the tour is shaped like that because that's the way you mined the hill in steps. It was a mining.
When earthly father Joseph died, Christ disappears from the Bible, and mother disappears, and it's 18 so-called missing years.
Right.
We have historical records in Britain that Joseph took the boy, his mother, to Glastonbury, England. And why Glastonbury? Because he'd been going there for years, trading the lead and tin of the Mendip Hills. He was in charge of the mining district there. And we know that we don't know how long Christ stayed there. Married and then built a church, I should say a home, which later became a church when she died. And she's buried someplace around Glastonbury. She lived about 15 years before she passed away.
Is to understand that there are old established links, biblically evident links between ancient Israel in the Middle East and the British Isles and northwest of Europe. And those links were established back in the times of the early kings, Saul, David, and Solomon in particular. In fact, you could say that the British Isles was actually an Israelite colony going back all those centuries before.
The Israelites have always been explorers.
Absolutely. And so Joseph of Arimathea was a wealthy mine owner. And in Cornwall to this day, they actually sing a song, Joseph was a tin man.
Right.
And there are records there, and even ordinary people down in Cornwall actually will refer to Joseph of Arimathea because they know all about that history. They are well aware that Joseph evidently had a home there as well as in Palestine. And the links are very, very strong and very, very real.
We also have books that told after when Christ, actually the disciple of Christ, left France, that's when Joseph of Arimathea took Mary and another group of disciples that were in that area and went to England. So there was this period of time that he was in, they were in France, and many of them stayed there, and Ewan's coming in.
Right.
He took them and went to Great England in Glastonbury, and that's where he went back to the house where he had established a home for Mary and the boy Jesus years before. And we know the records show that Mary lived about 15 years before she passed away, and the little house that she lived in, they converted into a chapel, and that became the Culdee Church. They built it actually around a round chapel. Later on, they built a regular rectangular chapel, and that became the Culdee Church, or Church of the Refugees.
Joseph of Arimathea figured in much in the Holy Scripture stories, but you see, Mary, the mother of the Lord, could not clearly have remained with John, although jurisdiction, what to do for Mary and her being taken care of, was given to John at the cross. But John, of course, was exiled later on at the Isle of Patmos. He did not have Mary with him. Mary was given to the jurisdiction of Joseph of Arimathea, probably by the Apostle John, and taken to the British Isles, to Glastonbury, which she had already been there many times because her own son, Jesus of Nazareth, was taken there by his great uncle to Glastonbury at the age of 12. Residing for many years because, of course, the house of David, the throne of David, was there in the British Isles. Why wouldn't Christ be educated where the throne of David is?
Glastonbury became a very sacred spot. In fact, it was the land had been given to Joseph of Arimathea when he first landed there.
Really?
And we have that in a record in the Doomsday Book. They gave him 12 hides of land. It's a matter of record. An interesting note that they made it tax-free.
Historical confirmation of the 1,900 acres of land mentioned in the traditions. It is found in the famous Doomsday Book of Britain.
The Domus Dei, the great monastery at Glastonbury called the Secret of the Lord. This Glastonbury church has in its own villa 12 hides of land which have never paid tax.
This is the beginning, I believe, of where cemetery property became tax-free. That's the first time they made that land him.
You read actually about many of the people that were in the first century church in Great Britain in the Holy Scriptures. You read about Pudens and Claudia and those people, and they were actually at the time they were in Rome at the Roman Britannicum. But Claudia was actually a British princess, and Linus, the first bishop of Rome, was actually a British prince, and that they were all part of the original church in the first century.
There was a person named Linus, don't know much about him, that was there before Peter. Now that is a confession that I didn't expect to hear. So Linus was the first bishop of Rome.
And not of the present Catholic Church. Or
no.
Right.
In fact, remember, it was some years before the Catholic Church became known as the under head of a pope. In fact, in Britain, I think about 400 years A.D., when Augustine came to Britain. And that man's name I'm trying to think of this morning. Augustine came to Britain, and he saw the church wrought without human hands by the hands of Christ himself for the salvation of people. That would be the cult church we talked about.
Right.
But now, Augustine, he was sent to England to get the church there, they were called Catholic, meaning universal. They were not under Rome. And he demanded that the church in Britain defer to Rome, the Pope, as the head church. And we have complete records of that in these books that tell how they said, well, we'll defer to him as any one Christian to another. That's for this man, John, who now calls himself Pope. We owe no allegiance. Jesus Christ is our vicar.
Amen.
And they're independent. In fact, I mentioned Iona being a sacred place. Sometime I'll talk about Iona
in Scotland,
the Cumming Church, and how the Cumming monks are the ones that had charge, you might say, of Christianity in Britain and that time, and how Rome took over and got them under the allegiance of the Pope. So the Pope is not in the first century, quite a few years before they called him Pope. He was a bishop of Rome, and when they had the Bishop of England, a Bishop of Britain. So there's a
vast history, though, that many people, again, are not aware of are the Christian roots and where the children of Israel migrated to, and the Christian foundation. And it's hard to look at this history and not think about the fact that, see, the disciples didn't go into China, they didn't go into Asia, they didn't go into the deepest parts of Africa. They went where the lost tribes of Israel were located at. They went to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Jesus, just as Jesus said, I have not come but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And Paul understood this. This is part of his calling as well, going into the Gentiles, meaning
nations. Not Jewish.
Jesus, I mean, God Almighty told Abraham, I'm going to make you a father of many nations, didn't he?
Mm-hmm.
And this term nations is goy in the Hebrew. In the Greek, it's ethnos, same word. He was sending Paul unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel who had been divorced and had become paganized, and all hope seemed to be lost for them. But then here comes a new covenant, what Jesus accomplished upon the cross, and he has redeemed them. He's bringing both tribes back into the bonds of a new covenant. I don't know about you, Mr. Cap, but that's an exciting story of our history.
And, of course, Paul, how did he get to Britain?
Right.
Because he got acquainted with Crassus, and after 7 years, Crassus was allowed to go home as a proe. He's almost like house arrest.
Right.
He had to promise not to ever take up arms against Rome again, and he went back home. And obviously, he invited Paul to go with him. And that's how Paul got to Britain. Now, we have evidence, records of Paul speaking to the Druids. And one of the places he spoke of is a hill called Mount Lud.
Right.
And on Mount Lud, he made a prophecy. And that kings and prophets, people would come and worship God on this mount. And that is where St. Paul's Cathedral is built today in England, right on that mount where he spoke to the Druids.
Now, Mr. Cap, one of the subjects we haven't touched on very much at all is St. Paul in Britain. Now, I've got the Bible here in front of me, and it says that there was an Ephesian Christian who accompanied Paul to Europe. And it's interesting that it says that because a lot of people aren't aware of the Christian faith going into Europe and, again, with the Gentilized, paganized Israelites who were already there, and Jesus said he's going to bring them back under the bonds of a new covenant in Hebrews chapter 8 and verses 8 through 10. But I want to share with you this scripture verse here in 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 21. This is Paul's closing words in Timothy. Here's what he says, quote, "Do thy diligence to come before winter, Epluvius greeteth thee, and Pertins, and Linus, and Claudia, and all the brethren." Now this verse has some great significance to it, and I'd appreciate if you just share with us some of your thoughts on what we've just read here.
Well, this is when he wrote the letter describing the friends of his in Rome. And some people think he never got to Rome by that time. He had definitely been there. Now, the name you mentioned, Pudens and Claudia, I have to go back a little bit. When Caradoc, or Crassus, as the Romans called him, was captured by the Romans in the wars in Britain, he was taken to Rome as a hostage with all his family. And among his family was his daughter, Claudia. Only her name was Gladys in those days. The Bible, the history, Roman history, is Gladys. And Linus was her brother. Those are relatives of the children of Caradoc or Crassus. Now, during the wars, they've been going on for quite a few years between the Britons and the Romans. They had a truce one time. And during that truce, Gladys, married Rufus Pudens. And some of the royal family intermarried. And it's very, very strange. Now, Pudens was a general in the army fighting Crassus. And the last, you'd never think of them ever getting together in marriage. They did. Now, you mentioned it said that Pudens, his mother and mine. Now, we try to tell somebody that Pudens is a half-brother of Paul.
Right.
They laugh at you. And yet, that's what it says. He said, either my mother, your mother, mine. Now, Paul's mother hadn't been married before. And so her husband's name, I can't recall right now, but we have a record of that. And so they were married. And their children, later in marriage, became the nieces and nephews of Paul. And their home is where Paul spent his time in doing his confinement, called the House of the Britons, Palace of the Britons.
Where was this located now?
In Rome.
In Rome.
Now, they have found the foundations was identified some years ago, and, of course, a building built on top of it now. But the location found, and some years ago, 10 or 15 years ago, there's a plaque there that said this is the home of Paul, where Paul stayed, Palace of the Britons. Now, when he was a captive, and instead of killing him, like they did most of them, and put him in prison, he stood up in the Senate to make declaration, and his daughter, Gladys, sit up with him. Now, as far as we can find out, it's the first time a woman was allowed to speak before the Senate in Rome. And she made an impassioned plea for her father, and she defied him. Now, that time, Claudius was the emperor in Rome at that time, Claudius. And he admired the smirk of this young girl. So much so, he adopted her as his daughter and changed her name to Claudia. So when the Bible mentions Claudia, that's the name that Claudius gave her. And so her aunt was also a prisoner.
She was a very bold lady, and she was. Bold.
And they describe her in the record, very beautiful girl.
Yes.
And she stood up for her father. And the father, he defied him. He said, "What glory you have killing me? Let me live, and Rome will get credit for being, you know, that war. You caught me by treachery. You didn't get me by war." Because one of his relatives double-crossed and turned his name over and where he was located to the Romans. That's how he was captured. It's a marvelous story. And
this is having to do with Paul's relatives and family and friends.
Yeah. Now, when Paul got acquainted, of course, with Crassus, and by the way, Gladys was a Christian, and Crassus' father was Bran the Great. He was a Christian. Now, at that time, Caradoc or Crassus was not a Christian yet, but his family were Christians and were taken to Rome. Now, you might wonder how they become Christians. Because Joseph Arimathea and his people are the ones that introduced Christianity to these people.
Oh, okay.
Caradoc's brother was the king, Arviragus. Mm-hmm. And he's the one that gave Joseph Arimathea the 12 hides of lamb. This is the Doomsday Book in England. So that's how Christianity actually came to Rome from Britain.
Now, we've already shared with you that the Christian gospel moved to Europe, and that these people that had settled in Europe mostly were Israelites, who had lost their identity. They were blind to their great heritage, their great biblical heritage, and it seemed like all was lost for them. But you remember earlier I shared with you the New Covenant? The New Covenant is first presented to us in Jeremiah chapter 31 and verse 31. And I want us to take a little bit of time just to read that over real quickly. Here's what it says, quote, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah." Understand that this new covenant is to the house of Israel and to the house of Judah. A lot of people refer to themselves as New Covenant Christians, but I'm going to tell you something very important here, that the people of the Old Covenant are the people of the New Covenant, and this is verified in Hebrews chapter 8. Now, these are the two places in the Word of God where the New Covenant is established and where the New Covenant is explained. So let's look here in Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 8 concerning this new covenant and see exactly who it's established to. "For finding fault with them," who's them? Israel, because they violated the covenant, the Mosaic covenant, the temporal covenant, not the Abrahamic covenant, but the Mosaic covenant where they entered into as a party together if they would keep their part of the agreement, and Israel, of course, didn't. So, fault was found with them. "For finding fault with them," he saith, "behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah." These two nations, or these two houses that had been divided, and it seemed like there was no hope of reuniting them and bringing them together here. But this new covenant is about bringing these two houses together under the bonds of a new covenant. And it says, "Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind, and I will write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. Now that's a fantastic story of love, and that's one of the main reasons why Jesus died upon the cross. Sure, he died upon the cross for salvation, but he also died upon the cross to redeem Israel and bring them both back under the bonds of a new covenant. A lot of this history is missing from the teachings of many Christian churches today because they don't understand this fantastic history of Israel. And this Bible, again, is essentially written to and for the Israel people. Now, the other races and the other nations can share and be blessed in the Word of God and in this great heritage that God Almighty has given Israel, but God Almighty is using Israel as His instruments. Israel is referred to over and over as His servant people. We are His servant people to bring forth this good news.
Because the whole purpose of God is to bless all the families of the earth. And the promise that Abraham was given in Genesis chapter 12 was specifically that through him would be blessed all the families of the earth.
That is good news that my good friend, Pastor Robert Phillips of Wales of the United Kingdom, just got through sharing with you concerning the gospel of the kingdom message. What we've been sharing with you throughout this documentary is the gospel of the kingdom message, and it is good news when it's properly understood. There's a lot of people that have shared information over the years, misrepresented what we really believe and what we really teach and the type of people that we are. But what we're giving you right now is the plain truth from God's Word concerning the covenant message. Now, when we're talking about the covenant message, we're talking about the kingdom of God. Jesus said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." And the kingdom of God is within you or among you. There are many things that Jesus said concerning the kingdom of God. And when you're talking about the kingdom, you're talking about many other things. And that's where we're going to be bringing together the New Jerusalem, Zion, for you. And it has a definite significance to you and your divine destiny. And a lot of people haven't put together, again, God's purposes, and it can be rather discouraging when you don't see the full picture. And we want to do our best to share with you this exciting information of God's plan of the ages. Now, involved in this kingdom is God's law. I want to share with you an important verse of Scripture. It's found in Proverbs chapter 6 and verse 23. Here's what it says, quote, "For the commandment is a lamp, and the law is light, and reproofs of instruction are the way of life." The scriptures say that God's law is light. Jesus said, "You are to be a light of the world." And he also spoke of his people, his remnant people, the overcoming category of people, the first fruit company, if you will, as being a light. Jesus said in Matthew 5 and verse 17, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all is fulfilled." Let me ask you a question, my friend. Has all been fulfilled? No. Well, a lot of people are telling us today that God's law is not important. It's been done away with. What was done away with? The blood rituals and the circumcision, the priestly rituals that they had to conduct under the old Mosaic law, those were done away with. But God's law concerning righteousness, lying, murder, adultery, God's commandments, they weren't done away with. No more than if you jump off the Empire State Building, my friends, you're going to see that the law of gravity is in force and effect. And God's law has an effect upon you. It has an effect upon your family, your community, your nation. Our nation is in trouble today because we have violated God's law covenant. And the law covenant is given in Hebrews chapter 8, which we've already shared with you, and which Jesus said, I'm not going to do away with the law, but I'm going to write my law in your heart. Now we have some exciting things to share with you on that law, but I want to share this with you right now. 1 John 3:4 says, sin is transgression of God's law. A lot of ministers have said, thou shalt not sin, and they're right. Well, what does it mean? 1 John, this is New Testament, New Covenant, says, sin is transgression of God's law. My friends, let's not belittle God's law. Let's understand it. Let's apply it. We're not saved by God's law. We're certainly not saying that. But Paul said, the law is our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, to show us our sin, and we repent and we turn to Jesus for our salvation and redemption. Amen. We're going to have some speakers now, some of my colleagues that are going to share some good information concerning God's law at this time.
Christianity, because Christianity is to be a way of life.
Yes, it enters into the whole of our warp and woof of our life. It enters into economics, it enters into sociology, it enters into law, it enters into everything. Now, one of the terrible things that modern evangelical world has brought to America is the abolishment of the law of God. And saying that it's all passed away. And as a result, they have eliminated half of their message, because the law structure of God is really the important thing.
So the entire Bible really deals with the kingdom, the people, the law, the land, the type of government, constitutional monarchy, and the king himself.
And the wonderful part I find about all of this is the consistency of God.
Yes.
Here we've got the consistency of God's plan coming through with his law, with Israel, from the Old Testament into the New Testament. And how can we overcome the law? The very fact that we have night and day, the very fact that we have the sunshine and the moon, and is all because God has a law, and that same law that applies to that comes to apply in our own lives with the commandments that he brings in.
And God's laws are not created to be grievous. They are created to protect us from ourselves, to protect us from temptations that will lead to turmoil.
Is this Israel message important? You know, I've had people come to me in the past and say, well, you know, Brother Barley, who the Israelites are really isn't important. We're just all Israelites by faith, and we don't really need to concentrate on that because that really gets into the vain genealogies and things like this. Well, I want to share with you something, friends. Our God is sovereign, and he, according to his sovereign purposes, called and he chose Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and he made an eternal, everlasting covenant with the seed of Abraham. Now, he didn't make a mistake in that. He did it for a purpose. And I want you to think about Israel again. Why did God call Israel? Why did he choose Israel?
I get asked so often, why is it so important? Is it really important to know who Israel is, for instance? Is that relevant to salvation? Well, in one sense, I would have to say it's not essential to salvation that I identify Israel. My salvation is on the basis of trusting in Jesus Christ as my Savior, that he died on the cross for
Amen.
Me, and I believe in him as my personal Lord and Savior. And nothing that I believe in Bible prophecy or regarding the national message can add to or take away from my salvation. But to understand the gospel, which is the gospel of the kingdom of God, I do need to understand the plan of God. So therefore, I say it's essential to understanding the plan of God, because the Bible tells us we are built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets.
Yes, it does.
The Lord Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. If I don't understand the words of the prophets, if I relegate them, or if I try to have some concocted idea of how the prophecies are being fulfilled, denying, in fact, the fulfillment of all of the great promises that God gave through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I only have to think, for instance, of the great statements that were given to Jacob and this, the inheritance that he passed on to his sons. We are told in Genesis 35, very definitely, that Israel was to become a nation and a company of nations. Now, that does not apply to just a relatively small number of people who, to the greater extent, are scattered through the earth or form the little Israeli state.
Right.
It has to be on a far bigger scale than that, because Rebecca, for instance, was told and was given the blessing that she would have a seed of multiplied millions. Multiplied millions. What happened to all those millions? They were not the 42,360 that returned from Babylon. These were all of those that went into Assyrian captivity that never went back to Palestine. But in fact, from the time of Jeremiah onwards, a transplantation was taking place. And they were being planted in a new land, an appointed place. Would be an appointed place. We know that Palestine was a promised land that was given to them. But the promise was also given to Jacob in Genesis 28, when he saw the ladder opened up to heaven in that wonderful vision that he had, that his seed would spread to the west, the east, the north, and the south. Not a little bitty people in one little bitty part of the earth, but they actually were going to be a massive people that would become a nation and company of nations on the face of the earth. And we as Christians are inheritors of this. This is why the gospel has been planted, why the wonderful Reformation took place throughout Europe, throughout the British Isles, why America has been planted by men that recognized that God was bringing them to a promised land. What a wonderful heritage we have. A heritage that's being undermined by people that are wanting to create one world system of government, yet not on God's plan, not on the basis of God's throne, not on the basis of the throne of David and the things that God has established in the earth. But we as Israel people have all these things today. We still have the essential constitution that God gave to Israel in the beginning. We have his law. We have his commandments. We have the oracles of God. We still have the throne of David, if people only realized it and recognized it amongst us. We still have all of the great promises of God, and God is going to fulfill all of those promises.
Consider this. If a lawyer came to you and said, hey, you have a will by a long-lost relative, and he's donated $25 million to you. All you have to do is prove that you are the person that is mentioned in this particular will, and you'll receive the money. Well, all of a sudden, who you are would become very, very important. You see, God Almighty has a very rich and a glorious heritage for us. He gave us this heritage, and he's purposed this heritage. And many people want to throw it away, they want to waste it, and they want to trivialize it. Well, we want to help you understand this rich and this glorious heritage that you have, that God Almighty has given you. And it has to do with the New Jerusalem, Zion, the kingdom of God. Hi, my friends. We're in the land of giants here in Northern California. Beautiful, magnificent redwood trees. It's hard to believe they're as big and grand as they are, but these trees are magnificent. Symbols, I believe, of covenant. God Almighty has given us many special things in His Word, and it is the glory of a king and the duty of a king to search out a matter and to learn the truth and to give forth that truth. Well, we're here to share some exciting news of God's covenant and God's promises to Israel. And we want to unfold for you the physical. We want to bring the physical and the spiritual together. You have a destiny, a great divine destiny. You have a rich heritage. The kingdom of God has an application and a direct bearing upon your heritage. The kingdom of God, we could say, is not here. That's only because many people do not understand the kingdom and what it represents. But the kingdom of God has a king. Jesus Christ is our king. He has a people. He has a law. It has a purpose. And when you have the scales removed from your eyes to see and understand this kingdom, what a glorious kingdom it is. And then when you add to that kingdom the New Jerusalem, wow. And we're going to do that for you. We're going to merge the physical and the spiritual for you.
He said, I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. And so he said to him, what's your name? And he said, my name's Jacob. I'm a chiseler. I'm a no good. I'm nothing. Well, the angelic being who was the Lord in a theophany form said to him, your name is not going to be Jacob anymore, but you're going to be known as Israel, a prince with God,
yes,
because you have prevailed. And so this is what Christianity really is, because the natural man moves into the spiritual realm where the living Lord of glory, the Lord Jesus Christ, comes to us and reveals himself and that word to us. And this is what makes Christianity become alive.
Hallelujah. That is a wonderful message. It's the gospel of the kingdom message.
The scriptures say that Jesus Christ is the author and the finisher of our faith. Yes, he is. He has a plan, a great plan of the ages. And Abraham fit into that plan. Abraham had a vision. He was a man of faith. Do you remember the scriptures over and over talked about the great faith of Abraham because he had a vision? Do you have a vision of God's purposes, or are they obscure, and are you just in the dark concerning most of God's plans and purposes? Well, I hope through this video you've come to understand a tremendous amount of light, and you've come closer to understanding that God Almighty really does have a plan. Now, Abraham, it says in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 10, that he looked for a city whose builder and maker is God. Abraham was already in the land of Palestine. The scriptures say again that he looked for a city whose builder and maker is God. A lot of people are looking to man for salvation and man for some great hope and in man's plans, and we're not looking there. As Christian people, people of faith, we need to look to Jesus Christ, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. Jesus said that his Spirit was to come and going to come and dwell in us, a people. He also said, in my Father's house are many mansions. Now, I want to ask you a question concerning that. Do you think that Jesus is up in heaven, putting lumber together and pouring concrete, building a great mansion for you? No, those many mansions are you and I, his many-membered body. It's a great body politic, and it concerns the kingdom of God. You see, he does have a plan. And we have shared with you earlier that this kingdom has to have certain things. A people, it has to have a law, it certainly has to have a king, and it's King Jesus, there's no doubt about that, and there's a purpose. So, understanding the New Jerusalem is understanding God's government, and that you and I are going to be a part of that government. And in order for us to be a part of that government, we have to die to ourselves. Jesus Christ has to be formed in us. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. And the Bible does say that our bodies are to be the temple of the living God. If our bodies are to be the temple of the living God, that means there has to be some serious changes that take place.
I've been talking to the Lord here, and I said, Lord, there's no revival. Everything is as dead as Adam's brindled ox. What's going on? And I said to her, the Lord just told me, Well, there's lots going on. You just don't see it. I said, I don't see it, Lord? No. He said, people are qualifying themselves for kingdom service, or else they are disqualifying themselves for kingdom service. And that's what's going on. And I said, Lord, I said, that is simply overwhelming to me, because now I understand what's happening. It's so tremendous that it's mind-boggling. We can't take it in. People are running hither and yon and turning away from churches and groups and the Bible and everything imaginable. When they have the opportunity to be a servant in the kingdom of God, they're turning away from the whole opportunity.
And they're missing a great blessing.
They're missing an eternal reward that is simply overwhelming, because he's calling us as his sons and daughters to be his helpers in the kingdom. And the kingdom is coming.
And again, Abraham looked for that city whose builder and maker is God. In Revelation chapter 22 and verse 14, the scripture verses say this, blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. What city is this? It's the New Jerusalem. And it says that those who do his commandments, and not just give it lip service, but do his commandments, are going to enter in. Now, the commandments have to do with light. We shared with that with you earlier. Light is what this earth needs right now. I remember reading, don't you, in the creation of this earth, God said, let there be light. There needs to be light. And there is going to be light. Because in the book of Revelation, chapter 21, listen to this, my friends, it's exciting concerning the New Jerusalem. John is having a revelation, and he says that God Almighty carried me away in a spirit to a great and a high mountain. Mountain means kingdom. And showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. And on down it says, and the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. But then in verse 12 it says, and had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and the names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. Is Israel important? Is this Israel message important? Absolutely. You see, God's plan is going to come together, and when you fit it together properly, then the revelation is going to become very real to you. And I'm telling you, my friends, I'm getting quite excited about it, just sharing this information with you here, because we're lively stones. Jesus Christ is the chief cornerstone. And that's said in 2 Peter or 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 5, that ye are lively stones, are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood. These are important words, because it has to do again with the New Jerusalem. And in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 20 and 22, it says that we are fitly framed together unto an holy temple. In verse 22, it says that ye also are builded together for an habitation of God through the Spirit. Christ formed in you. Christ the living Word. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And that I am the light of the world. Jesus said, there's a city that is set upon a hill. And this city is to be a light. Well, in Revelation chapter 21, and you may want to get your Bibles and turn there with me, because this is very key again to what is going to happen. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 11 says this concerning the New Jerusalem, that God's glory is going to fill this New Jerusalem. It says, and her light, this New Jerusalem, was like unto a stone most precious. What stone? The stone kingdom.
The stone kingdom is the kingdom of God and is the actually the kingdom of the Israel people in the latter days, which smashes this great statue in Daniel to pieces, and we have the coming of the kingdom of God.
There's going to be a new heaven and a new earth, a new government upon this earth, and you and I are going to be a part of that government. And God's Spirit and God's truth is going to fill His people, and the book of Revelation says there's going to be no need of light because the light of God is going to shine forth in His people. Remember Moses that was on the mountain receiving the oracles with the commandments of God, and he came down with these commandments in his hand, and the scriptures say that there was a light coming forth or emitting from his face, and the people were fearful of because they didn't understand that light. Well, that's a type of the Shekinah glory. That's an example of the light and the truth that's going to come forward from this New Jerusalem company, and the other nations are going to see it, and they're going to come to this kingdom, and they're going to want to see and know what this light is. What is this glory? What is this great kingdom that's emerging here? Well, it's kind of like King Solomon during his day and that temple that he built in the great kingdom that he had. Many nations and many people and kings and queens came to King Solomon to see what this kingdom, this great kingdom, was all about. Well, my friends, God's forming a kingdom, a new Jerusalem company of people, Zion, that is going to transform this world. And this creation is groaning and travailing for the sons of God to be revealed. My friends, wake up to your heritage. It's a great and glorious heritage. And this documentary, this information that we provided you in here, is going to help feed you, your soul, and awaken the sons of God to their true heritage. God bless you.